Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm DJ Titan here with the one, the only Dieselboy, here to talk about new music, tours, and all kinds of other stuff. So let's start with talking about the tour with Planet of the Drums right now. You started doing that again.
Right, so Planet of the Drums, which is myself, AK, and Dara, and Messinian, we kind of put the tour to bed a few years ago. We thought we would do 10 years, and that would kind of, you know, we would have kind of reached our goal. We felt we had done it long enough. And then last year, we decided we were going to maybe resuscitate it for a few shows. We did 3 shows last year, and now this year, we don't have all the shows in yet, but we're definitely planning on doing some touring this summer because, you know, the reality is we've gotten a lot of feedback. Kids were excited about the tour that we used to do, and they want to see us do it again. So we're trying to bring it back for some of the old school heads, and yeah.
That's awesome. I'm sure they appreciate it. That's very cool. So more recent years, in the past, you know, I guess 2012, 11, you started touring with Bear of, you know, Planet Human, your own record label. Right. Tell me more about playing with him versus your old drum and bass sets and stuff like that.
You know, that the tour with Bear was really more of a, it wasn't just Bear, it was a Subhuman tour that we did. We called it the Subhuman Beatdown, and it was people like Bear, Smash Gordon, who I do the label with, and other people on the label, Mark Instinct, Number 9, Mayhem. We haven't really discussed doing that tour this year, but probably in the fall we're going to try to coordinate something where it's going to be, yeah, a tour like featuring the label artists and people on the roster. And yeah, I mean, it's a completely different experience. So with Planet of the Drums, when we perform, it's like a 3-man kind of jazz session where we riff off each other while we DJ. Subhuman tour is more like we're highlighting the different artists. So it's, we each have our own set. It's not like the kind of 2x4 setup you would see with Planet of the Drums. So it is a bit different.
Gotcha. Awesome, man. Well, you know, with the whole bass music shift, with drum and bass being so prevalent in the United States at one point, now dubstep taking over, trap music, all that other stuff. Just simply put, what's your take on all that stuff?
I mean, for a while, I mean, I'm an open-minded person musically. Like, I do like all kinds of music. People know me for drum and bass, but the reality is I listen to everything. So there were a few years have gone by where I've tried to incorporate other sounds into my set just to kind of expand my horizons, just kind of play around with it. But the reality is that I've always loved playing drum and bass. That's my heart and soul. And in the past probably 6 months, I've kind of gone back to playing pretty much 100% drum and bass. Because what was happening is every show I would play, promoters would ask me if I was playing drum and bass at night. Kids would be on my Facebook page, are you going to play drum and bass? And it's like, I was always a drum and bass DJ, but I was just like, if that's really the feedback I'm getting, I might as well just go back to what I truly love anyways, which is just playing drum and bass. So tonight here at Lizard Lounge, that's what you're going to hear me play is.
Amazing. Thank you. Awesome. That's really good info. Now let's talk about a little bit about the current music state. Who are you playing right now? Who's your favorite? What's the best song you play at the end of the night? That sort of thing.
I mean, I don't want to give away my outro tonight, but some of the artists that I really like nowadays are BTK and Optive, who I feel are pretty much like the next generation Ed Rush and Optical. I do like Upbeats, TC, Original Sin. There's an artist, Ine, E-N-E-I, which is more minimal drum and bass, but really well-produced stuff. I like his stuff. And then there's Neo Signal, which is Face and Misanthrope. I really like their stuff. But yeah, those are kind of like the artists that I'm really playing the majority of my music of is their stuff.
Now let's talk about some stuff you don't play. I mean, I know you're a fan of metal, all kinds of rock, whatever. What are you listening to in the car right now? Like when you get in, you have to...
Well, I've actually never owned a car, surprisingly enough. I can drive. But it's funny, you know, when I'm out at a club, I don't listen to dance music outside of the club. And when I'm at a club, it's usually drum and bass because that's what I'm playing. But when I'm home, I usually listen to a lot of obscure indie rock, some metal. I like to listen to a lot of old bands that are influenced by groups like Slow Dive and My Bloody Valentine, like shoegaze kind of influenced indie rock. But I mean, like Toro y Moi is a band or a guy that I really like. I like indie rock. Like I like mellow, kind of bittersweet music when I'm home. And then when I'm at the club, I like to have really aggressive music.
Awesome. Well, real quick, can we talk about some influences, something that you started listening to and that kind of got you into maybe EDM or the sound or, the aggressive style that you play?
When I started DJing initially, I was listening to like early Moby. You know, he was really kind of breaking on the scene. Early Richie Hawtin, early Josh Wink. Those people kind of inspired me. But then there was an old record label, an old jungle drum and bass label called Reinforced Records and Moving Shadow and Suburban Bass. And those labels really sucked me into like what eventually became drum and bass, but those were my earliest influences. But even before that, I was into like I feel like what pushed me towards electronic music was bands like Depeche Mode, New Order, and then further on is like Front 242, Frontline Assembly, Nine Inch Nails, like the industrial kind of scene, and then yeah, band or labels like Suburban Bass and Moving Shadow and Rainforest.
Awesome, that's very cool info as well. Now, I'm just to touch back on the tour stuff for a second. Is there any kind of crazy story that you can share with us that just you know that you can share with us that you're willing to share?
I mean, the funny thing is there are so many crazy stories that happen that you can't really share because it's not cool to talk about. So a lot of fucked up shit happens in the behind the scenes in the race scene. I would always think to myself, like, if people only had any fucking clue like what goes on behind the scenes, they'd be like, whoa, that is fucked up. I mean, not really. I get asked this question a lot. I mean, nothing really crazy. I mean, some of the crazy shit I do is like signing people's foreheads, which I think is absolutely ridiculous. You know, people getting tattooed. Like, I've signed people with Sharpie, then they don't wash it off, and they tattoo the Sharpie autograph on their bodies, which is bizarre. No, I mean, nothing too crazy. I mean, people like vomiting all over themselves in the front row. I mean, that kind of shit, I guess, maybe is not too crazy, just kind of ridiculous, but no.
Awesome. Well, what's the best gig you've ever played? Hands down, you know, maybe top three if it has to be. Just the best, most memorable moment you've had.
I have two, actually. I used to do a night in Philadelphia called Platinum. It was a drum and bass weekly, 21 and up. Sure. So the final, we did the final Platinum was in 2004. That was probably, Dara played at it.
Set the speakers on fire?
Speakers might have been on fire. That was probably one of my favorite gigs of all time, only because it was a small crowd, 300 people, but the vibe and the energy was like palpable.
It's kind of like what Cascade's doing now, that small tour.
Right. Yeah. It's amazing. But I got to say, there was that gig. But then when I played Bonnaroo a few years ago, that was probably the best sound system I ever played on. So from a personal pleasing angle, playing on that sound system was... It might not have been the best show of my career, but it was just like just hearing my music that intensely was amazing.
That's awesome. I guess last but not least, are there any tips or you know advice you want to offer to new upcoming producers or even DJs or whatever? I mean, I referenced your "Can I Get a Witness" interview all the time. I copy and paste it. I'm going to put it on my new. Yeah, but it's still very relevant, except for the gear sort of thing. But you know, you've always been one to offer great advice. So, is there anything you want to say now, 2013 versus 2003?
I mean, it's hard. It's hard to give advice now because I feel like from the era that I come from, I like DJing, and that's been my goal. And I feel like with a lot of the new producer DJ people, DJing is now the obstacle. It's not the activity that's fun, something that should be perfected. It's become like, I feel like the reason a lot of people try to play out now is just to be cool rather than trying to perfect a craft, so to speak. So my advice, though, probably would be, though, just don't be a fucking asshole. And whenever you sign a few autographs or get a few Facebook fans, like, don't become a fucking asshole. Like, I've met some really amazing people in this industry that have like really inspired me. And I've met a bunch of like people that have gotten a little bit of fame and they're just fucking assholes. And like,
those are usually the first to burn out within a year or two. I mean, sometimes, you know,
yes, but I just, you know, be humble and focus and try to fucking raise the bar for yourself and try to be better than everyone else around you. I just try to be inspired and then set the bar high for yourself. That's what I try to do with my own shit. I'm still trying to do that. I still set the bar as high as I can possibly set it. And I feel like that is what most people should do.
Awesome. Well, thank you very much, Damien, for taking the time today. You're about to kill it. Here it is, 5 minutes till 12:30, May 11th, 2013, with the one, the only Diesel Boy. Thank you so much.
Thanks. Thank you.